niet zo. Put.
Yes.
So, hello. This is the third session. In this third session, I will speak. Let's say the title of this third session will be analytic functions. We shall make a strong relation between holomorphic functions and what I'm going to define right now, analytic functions. So, just to define analytic functions, we need to recall some basic facts about power series, about series of complex numbers and power series. So, in general, consider a power series centered in a point z0. Take a point z0 C, a power series would be some expression of this kind, where the A, N are in general complex numbers. This is a series, polynomials, let's say. So you can speak about the domain of convergence, etc. It's not a restriction to assume that z0 in the following, that z0 will be 0. All facts can be easily translated from the facts stated when z0 is equal to 0 to another point. So let us consider power series of this kind, an zn. One such series may converge or not on a point z. Okay. Okay, what happens if it converges? Assume for instance that this power series converges in a point. So this is a series of complex numbers now, and assume it converges. So it converges to a certain sum s at a certain point, z0. Okay, what happens in this case? So we have our point 0 here, the origin, and we have some point z0. Most of the facts are going to be exactly the same as the usual facts for power series in real variables. Well, in fact, they are exactly the same, all the facts. Okay, so assume it converges at a point z0, different from 0, of course. So, take a circle here. So take R, the modulus of z0, and take a circle of radius exactly r. We're going to see that in fact the power series converges inside this circle. So take for instance any smaller radius. Here take some r prime smaller than r, and consider the disk centered at the origin, the closed disk centered at the origin of radius r prime. This is a compact set. And what happens in this compact set? If you take a point in this compact set, what happens with this power series? Well, first of all, if this series converges, by the basic facts about series of real or complex numbers, the general term tends to zero. In particular, the general term is bounded. So there is a bound of these terms are bounded by a certain constant, real constant, positive, big M. So an n, assuming that z is in this smaller closed disk, this could be bounded by the following. An is smaller than m, modulus of z0 to the n, here zn. And this is smaller than, z is smaller or equal than r prime, z0 is equal to r, so this is m r prime r to the n, and this is a geometrical series, a convergent geometrical series, r prime is smaller than r, so this converges. This is a convergent series. So using Weierstrass M test, we see that this is a sequence, a series of functions, of holomorphic functions, let's say, of continuous functions for the moment, that converges absolutely in any smaller disk. So in particular, the sum is a continuous function. So it in particular, it converges in all the disk, and the sum is a continuous function. So this expression defines a continuous function in the open disk, as R prime could be taken arbitrarily smaller to R. So we have this open. So what is important is the following fact: if a power series converges at a point, it converges absolutely at any point in the circle, in the disk, let's say, defined by its point. So the domain of convergence of a power series must necessarily be, the interior of the domain must necessarily be a disk. Because if it converges at a point, it converges in the whole disk. Another thing is what happens in the boundary of the disk. In the points in the boundary, it may converge in some points, may not converge in another points, etc. But what we say, if it converges in a point, it converges absolutely in the whole disk and uniformly in any smaller compact disk, defining thus a continuous function. Okay? Well, it's not always continuous, not only continuous, but this function also can be derivated. So this is this would be a function defined in this disk, and it turns out that this function is in fact holomorphic, so you can compute the derivative of the function f. F is holomorphic. Well, directly you can compute the derivative of the function f by the usual rules, applying some bounds, etc. So it's holomorphic, and in fact the derivative, as usual, exactly the same as in the real case, the derivative can be computed as the following sum. So you can take the derivative term by term of the series. Okay? You know that in general it's not true that if a sequence of differentiable functions in one variable, if a sequence converges uniformly, it's not true that the sequence of the derivatives converges uniformly in general. But in the case of a series, it is true. In the case of a series of power series, it is true. You can do it term by term, it's no problem. So in particular, you can derivate once. This defines, again, a power series with the same disk of convergence. We are going to say something about that in some minutes. So this defines also a function that this continues in the same disk. And by the same reasons as before, this is in fact another holomorphic function. So you can derivate it again. So in fact, a function defined on a disk by a power series, in fact, it is infinitely differentiable. You can derivate it as many times as you want. Okay? So it's a C-infinity function. And an analytic function will be defined. We will say that the function is analytic. Assume that U is an open set of a complex plane, and take a function f from U to C. We'll say that this function is analytic if for every z0, for every point z0 in U, there exists a disk totally contained in U And a power series defined on this disk defining the function. So the function can be represented in disk, in some disk containing every point, by a power series. A function can be represented like this. We will say that this function is analytic. From the theory of functions, in particular, an analytic function is infinitely many differentiable, and we know what are the values of the derivatives at any point, because we have this expression. For instance, here is centered at zero. A zero, of course, is the value of f at zero. The derivative we have derivated here would be n a one. So a one would be the derivative. In general, the term a n is the nth derivative divided by n factorial, as usual. So, well, knowing the power series means to know the values of all the derivatives at least at that point. What is important is that the values at this point determines, in some sense, the values of the function at the rest of the points. As you know from the theory of real functions in one variable, it's not equivalent to say that the function is infinitely differentiable, can be differentiated infinitely many times, to say that it is analytic. There are functions that can be differentiated as many times as you want, but are not analytic. And not analytic. The typical function in the real case, typical such example is a function like this. Consider, for instance, function defined as exponential of minus 1 over x to the x square if x greater than 0, and 0 if x is smaller or equal than 0. You can verify easily that this function is infinitely, can be differentiated infinitely many times at 0. It's not difficult to verify that. It's an exercise for any first year calculus student, more or less, and the derivative are zero. All the derivatives at this point are zero. So this function cannot be represented by a power series, because if it could be represented by a power series, all the coefficients must be zero. So near zero, all the coefficients, the power series is this one, all the coefficients might be zero, and the function would be identically zero. But this is not an identically zero function in a neighborhood of zero. It's an identically zero on the left, but not on the right. So this is an example of a C-infinity function, non-analytic. Non-analytic, okay? Okay, so we have analytic function. Analytic functions have a radius of convergence, as I have said before. The radius of convergence can be computed, in fact. Can be computed, in fact, it's not difficult to show that the following fact. Assume you have a power series and compute this number. Take rho, let rho be the upper limit of the sequence nth square and nth root of the modulus of an. You take this number. This is a positive number, or perhaps zero, or perhaps zero, perhaps infinity. So we have the following. If rho is zero, this power series converges everywhere. The radius of convergence is infinity. So it defines a function everywhere, in the whole complex plane. If rho equals infinity, the radius of convergence is zero. So it does not define any function. beyond the origin, of course. Defines a point, but does not define the radius of a convergence is zero. And if rho is a strictly positive real number, the radius of convergence is 1 over rho. And this is very easy to verify. Let's verify, for instance, this fact. What happens if the radius of convergence, this limit is a strictly positive real number, okay? Taking epsilon positive small enough, as small as you want, to say that this limit, this upper limit is rho, it means that it exists an index such that if n is greater than this index, this root is smaller than rho plus epsilon. So a n must be smaller than rho plus epsilon to the n in modulus. So the series in modulus and this converges when, for instance, this is a geometrical convergence series, if this is smaller than 1. So this converges if z is smaller than 1. So it defines a function, at least in this disk, in the disk of radius 1 over rho plus epsilon. But epsilon was any positive number. So in fact, it defines a disk here, a holomorphic function in this disk, where r is 1 over rho, taking the limit when epsilon tends to 0. Okay, and so this verifies, it converges here, and the same argument can be used to see that the power series cannot converge outside this disk. In fact, if you could find a point z0 of modulus is greater than r, explicitly greater than r, you could see that in this disk, this point, the series cannot converge. Using the same argument as before, the terms an an 0 to the n must be bounded. Okay, this must be bounded, and this would imply that this limit must be smaller than rho, necessarily, smaller than rho, smaller than 1 over r. And this point, 1 over r, is rho here. The same argument, okay? So we have power series defining holomorphic functions in disks. And we have even a mean of computing the radius of convergence of such a power series. Using this formula there, it can be verified that the radius of convergence of a series and of its derivative must necessarily be the same, because essentially, if you take this series here and you take this series here, in this case, to compute the radius of convergence, we must compute the limit. This limit here. And in this case, we might compute the upper limit of, well, really of the n minus 1 root, but it's going to be essentially the same. Essentially that, this limit, but as you know, this tends to 1, so finally the two limits are the same. So the radius of convergence of a series and of its derivative is always the same. And of by recurrence, the radius of any of the derivatives must be exactly the same, must have exactly the same radius of convergence. Okay? So we have we have seen that we have some series, there are some holomorphic functions that could be defined by power series, and we have called them analytic functions. The objective is to show the converse, that a holomorphic function is always analytic. And that's a very, very key fact of the theory of complex functions, that every holomorphic function is in fact analytic. How can we see that? In order to see that, I'm going to make the following computations. Assume, for instance, that we have a function, holomorphic function, okay, defined an open set, and this open set contains a disk. This open set contains a disk. Okay? We're going to consider in this disk the following function. Take a function defined by g of omega of w, defined as f of w minus f of z, f of z. Take a point z, fix z. Z in the disk, for instance, in the interior of the disk, the interior. Take a point Z and consider this function defined like this. If W is different from Z and okay. Well, if you consider this function in this disk, or if you want, you have here your open set U, you have an open a closed disk here that is always included, of course, in a slightly greater open disk still contained in the open set U, but what is important is this greater disk is convex. Let's say we have you have a convex set contained in U. You have here defined a function G that is holomorphic in this, let's say, d prime, this slightly greater disk, this holomorphic in this d prime, except perhaps in the point zero, in the point z. We don't know for a moment the definition, but it's by the definition, as g, as f is holomorphic, g is continuous, this limit here, so g is continuous. In all this, so we have a function that is holomorphic in a disk, perhaps, but a point, but continuous in this point. So to this function, we could apply Wursatz theorem this morning, the stronger version of Wursatz theorem. So the integral of this function along any triangle must be zero, and this was enough to see, it was enough to prove that this function had a primitive, and because of that, the integral along any closed path might be zero. So the integral of this function g is zero along any closed path. In particular, the integral is zero along the circle here. So call gamma let gamma be the circle centered at the zero of radius r here, okay? And so the integral, this integral zero. What is this integral? This would be the integral, so we have this gamma here, and we have here the point z0, and this is a point z somewhere in the interior. But doesn't so to integrate along this circle, we only need to use this expression. So this would be the integral along this circle of f I'm going to write like this. This integral must be zero. We integrate with respect to omega. The variable is here. So this is a constant. So in fact, I could have put this number outside the integral. And this number is zero. So let us consider this expression here. Let us consider this expression. Okay? Let us study this expression. How? What is the value of this expression? What is the value of this expression? So write like this. This is the integral of 1 over w minus z0 minus z minus z0. I'm going to write like this. The omega here. And write like this. This one. Z minus z0 dividing by omega minus z0, and what is important here, z minus z0 is this length, the modulus of this number is this length, and omega minus z0 in modulus is the radius, because we are integrated along the, so omega is any point of the circle, we are integrated along the circle. So this is r. So in modulus, this is smaller than this number. So you can develop this. You can develop this expression using the geometrical series. So in fact, this is here, okay, and using the Weierstrass M test, you can see that this along this circle, this series converges uniformly along this circle, because all these values lesser is in absolute value in modulus is smaller than one, so this integral, this sum converges uniformly. So as you know, from and this fact is exactly the same in the theory of functions or real variable, if a sequence of functions, of integrable functions, converges uniformly to another function, this the limit is integrable also, and the integral of the limit is the limit of the integral. You can exchange the integral and limit if the convergence is uniform. It's one of the conditions to allow to exchange. So you are in the setting here, so this could be integral of this sum. And what is the value of this integral here? Remember one example. In the previous lectures, we have computed the integral of 1 over z, the function 1 over z, along a circle. Well, I put the circle of radius 1, but any circle, in fact, could serve. Circle, in this case, centered at the origin. And in fact, we have computed this number. For any n, we have seen that this number for any n is along this circle is 0 if n is different from minus 1, and 2 pi I if n is equal to minus 1, is what we had seen. So we're more or less in the same situation. Here in the integral, this is a constant we can put outside the integral. So we have the integral along a circle centered at z0 of the function omega minus z0. So in fact, it's the same. Instead of being centered at zero, we are centered at the point z0, but the computation is the same. So all these integrals, plus one, are zero except when n plus one is minus one. So except when except when n plus one is one in this case. So except when 2 pi I, when n equals to zero in this case. Okay. So finally, we obtain that this integral, all the integrals are zero when n equals to zero is 2 pi I. So this integral, in fact, the value is 2 pi I. The sum 2 pi I plus infinitely many zeros, so 2 pi I. So we have arrived to the following formula, that f of z, following interesting formula, that f of z is equal to 1 over 2 pi I times the integral along this circle for any z, and this form, this is valid for any z contained in the disk. Any z contained in this disk. So this is the first issue of what we are going to call Cauchy theorem. So this is what is called Cauchy formula for a disk. Cauchy formula for a disk. And this has very important implication. In particular, what we have, what we can see from this formula, the values of f in any point of the disk are determined by the values on the circle, because we are integrating on the circle. So we are only using the values of the function small f in the circle, and it determine, they determine the values in any point of the disk. Okay? Another thing, small comment, we will speak a little bit more about this formula after, but it's interesting to state it separately, the value of this integral. So it is interesting to state that what we have shown is essentially the following fact. We have shown that if we consider a circle like this, and we consider this integral, this integral could be defined for any values of z not over the line, not over the path, because in that case the denominator could be zero. So we have shown, in fact, that this number here is 2 pi I when z is a point in the interior of the disk. In the interior of the disk. And what happens, what would have happened if we had chosen a point z at the exterior of the disk? Well, we have chosen a point here. We consider an open set. Here, in this open set, this function would be holomorphic, and this is a convex set. So, called holomorphic function in a convex set, the integral along any loop is zero. So we have these two alternatives for any value of z. It's or 2 pi I in the interior, or zero if we have taken a point z at the exterior of the disk. We have not used this fact, we only have used this fact. But what we have seen is at least this formula here. The first consequence of this formula, the first very important consequence of this formula. So, we have that f of z is equal to this. Along this circle, I abbreviate by this. First consequence, we are going to write this like this. Divide the denominator, so divide by omega here, or write like this. And as before, you take a point z in the disk, inside the disk, the modulus of z is strictly smaller than r, the radius of the circle. So, so it can be developed. Can be developed like this, and as before, by uniform convergence, you can exchange the integral and the sum, and write like the sum of z to the n is a constant, so we are going to write like this, z to the n, I put it here, and I put it here, that 1 over pi I times can write it like this, a change in the value. And what is that? You call a n this number, this is a power series. This is a power series, so f is analytic. So we have shown a very important fact that holomorphic functions are analytic. Why this is, what is surprising in some way, this is a main difference, perhaps the main difference between the real variable calculus, let's say, and the complex variable calculus. In the real variable function that has a derivative, the differentiable function, need not to be further differentiable. Perhaps you cannot differentiate it twice or three times, etc. Even if you can differentiate it as many times as you want, you have a infinity function, it does not need to be analytic. Perhaps it cannot be represented as a power series. But here, we have shown that a function, a holomorphic function, is analytic because, well, you have a function in any open set, you fix a point, you take a disk around this point, you use this argument, you see that in that disk, the function can be represented as a power series. So, in particular, consequences, basic consequences, are the following. As a basic consequence, we have the following, that consequence. First, that a holomorphic function is infinitely differentiable. Holomorphic function is almost a miracle. So a function, you can derivate a function once, and you can derivate as many times as you want. You can do the derivative as many times as you want for holomorphic functions. This is a crucial difference between the theory of one variable real functions and one variable complex functions. Okay. Another results that could be deduced from this fact. Well, not only differentiable, but they can be represented as power series, of course. They can be represented as power series. And for instance, a third consequence. Assume you have a continuous function U, an open set, and F continuous. Continuous function on U with values, with complex values. So, assume that for every triangle, T completely contained in U, the integral along the border of T of F is zero. Assume that this happens, then F is holomorphic. F is holomorphic. Why? You have a complex, a continuous function on an open set U. This condition, recall from this morning, this condition was enough to enough for us to be convinced that this function had a primitive. So, using this condition, F has a primitive. Big F. So, and now we know that this primitive, as it's a primitive, you can derivate it, so this is holomorphic. And you know now that a holomorphic function is infinitely differentiable. So the derivative of a holomorphic function is, in particular, is again holomorphic. So as if big F is holomorphic, small f is holomorphic.
Didn't we take F as holomorphic in the S?
Yes, no, we took F as holomorphic. We have seen that if F is holomorphic, the integral along any triangle is zero. Now I am assuming that I take a continuous function and I suppose that the integral is zero along any triangle. In this case, it must be holomorphic. The primitive could be found in the same way this morning. If we know this assumption, if we assume that the integral is zero, the primitive could be found. Take a point zero could be found. Taking the integral along any segment here, and the only problem was in the formula for the derivative was that this might be zero. To have that the difference between the two expressions would be the integral small integral along this small segment, but we have seen that if the integral of any along any triangle is zero, the function has a primitive. If the function has a primitive, the function is the derivative of a holomorphic function, so it's again holomorphic. In particular, it's again holomorphic. So this result that a continuous function such that the derivative, such that the integral along any triangle is zero, must be holomorphic is what is called Morera's theorem. Morera's theorem. Okay? You can show that a function is holomorphic from the continuity. For instance, a consequence of Morera's theorem also. Assume that you have a sequence of holomorphic functions. Assume you have an open set U, another consequence. Assume you have an open set U and a sequence of holomorphic functions defined on U, and you know that this sequence of holomorphic functions converges to another function F You know that the limit of a sequence of even continuous functions need not to be continuous, but assume that this convergence is uniform in every compact set. Uniformly in every compact set. Compact set contained in U. So you have a sequence of holomorphic functions that converges towards another function, and this convergence, you know that is uniform in every compact set. What can you say about the limit? Well, first of all, the limit is continuous. Why? Because it's continuous at every point. Because you have your open set U, here you have a point here, for instance, at zero, take a closed disk. Here, this closed disk is compact, so as the convergence is uniform in the compact sets, the convergence is uniform in this closed disk, and you know that a sequence of continuous functions that converges uniformly, the limit is again continuous. So the function is continuous here. You can do it around any point, so the limit is continuous. And second, why? Something more that can be said. Take a triangle contained in U. Take a triangle contained in U and take the border of the triangle. The border of the triangle is a compact set. And you know that this is zero because Fn are holomorphic. And you know from Gursat's theorem that the integral along any triangle of L holomorphic function is zero. But now Fn converges to F uniformly in this border because this border is compact. And if convergence is uniform, the integral, you can exchange integral and limit. So the integral of the limit is the limit of the integrals, so the limit of zero is zero. So the limit is a continuous function such that the integral along any triangle is zero. So by Morera's theorem, F is holomorphic. F is holomorphic. And more can be said. I'm not going to show, but exactly, in full detail, but more can be said. If you have a sequence Fn of holomorphic function in an open set U that converges uniformly in every compact sets, uniformly in compact sets, to a function F, we know that this F, we have shown that this F is holomorphic, but not only that, the derivatives converges to the derivatives. The derivatives of any order converge uniformly in compact sets to the derivatives. And this is quite surprising, in fact. So uniform convergence in compact sets implies convergence of all the derivatives of any order. So we have shown a good number of facts. I'm going to finish here. A good number of facts today in this third session. Mainly that any holomorphic function is analytic, so it can be represented by a power series, not only by a power series, but by an integral as above. I will see in the next session that this also allows us to compute with an integral all the derivatives easily. Okay. And that convergence of holomorphic functions in compact sets implies that the limit is again holomorphic and the derivatives converges also uniformly in compact sets towards the corresponding derivatives. And these are facts that make a great difference between the real, let's say, real variable functions and complex variable functions. In the next session, we will see mainly some consequences of this Cauchy formula. That after that, we will extend to a more general situation, not only to integration along some paths, you know, to another kind of now in that formula the path is very simple, it's a circle, but if you consider more general paths, how can you reinterpret this formula? And the idea is going to be in this integral. The key is going to be more or less in this integral that we will give a name in the next session. But for a moment, I finish here this introduction to analytic functions. Thank you.